the buildings and changed history. They stood for an hour once the damage was done, but then suddenly crumbled. 10 seconds they were gone. There were cascading projections of steel into dust. It looked like explosions, but it was not disgust. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound for heaven. I'm just sharing the truth about 9/11. Now, building number 7 dropped the cleanest of all. Yet the world still knows nothing of this amazing free fall. There was no real reason. It wasn't hit by a plane. They say it was a fire, yet you can't see the flames. You see cascading projections of steel into dust. Looks like demolition, but it's never discussed. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound. Sharing the truth about 9/11. They say that the bigger the lie, the more people believe. And the deeper the fear, the more easily we are deceived. Turn off the TV and I shut out. Just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound for heaven. I'm just sharing the truth about 9/11. Yes, I'm sharing the truth about 9/11.
Welcome back to, this is the last episode before the 13th anniversary, it's on the 2014, but it's 13th anniversary of the tragic 9/11 event. I don't like to call it a terrorist attack, unless you want to call the, what? Oh, my mic isn't working. Okay, I'm going to switch over to the lavalier. Okay, technical problems with the RF mic. Sorry about that. Okay. Well, you know, they pay us the big bucks. Cable access. Okay. Now, what I was saying was that this is the 13th anniversary in a few days. This is the last show that I have before the 13th anniversary. And I have David Fura of Portland AE 9/11 Truth with me to recap what's happened and to talk about events coming up on this anniversary. So go ahead and give us the two shot and I'll introduce Dave. There we go. Here's Dave on my left. And we took down the green screen because he was wearing a green shirt and we didn't want it to distract. That. You'd see right through him and we don't need to see burning flames through him. But so tell us what is happening this weekend.
Okay, so I want to make sure I say this at least twice. So I'll start again. I'll start off with what we're doing this week, and what we're going to do tomorrow at the Laurelhurst Park is to have a picnic. We'll be there from about 1 to 7, and the barbecue will be going about 4 o'clock or so. And
Laurelhurst Park, you're going to be near the duck pond?
We're going to be pretty close to the duck pond on the southeast corner.
Southeast corner, okay.
This picnic area C, there's going to be a canopy there with a bunch of our banners hanging down.
Oh, it's catered. You're having canopies. No, oh, sorry, I just... 9/11 event is just a little bit...
It'll be a bring your own hot dog catering affair.
Okay.
Beer and wine is acceptable, though. But we'll have a little bit of a work party, too. So we're going to be planning out some activities that we'll be doing on Thursday, the 11th.
Do we have a graphic for that? No, we didn't do that.
Don't have a graphic for that.
No but problem.
We're going to be downtown on Thursday. Some of us will be there all day. I'll be there after I get off work at 5 to 7 at Pioneer Square. We'll be starting off there and marching around with our signs and flyers.
And that's
brochures.
Which day?
That's over Pioneer.
That's okay. The picnic's tomorrow.
Yes. And tomorrow we'll be making signs and doing some brochure work for the event on Thursday.
Okay.
Which is at Pioneer Courthouse Square.
It. Okay.
But there'll be people there all day. So if you want to get there before 5 o'clock and do something, that'll be great. And then next Saturday we have a library showing of 9/11 Experts Speak Out, the 9/11 documentary from AE. And that'll be at the Belmont Library.
Did you notice, if you go to the AE 9/11 Truth site, the one Richard Gage founded, you'll see that they took that Experts Speak Out and they broke it up into 20 little short sections, each the chapters, if you will, so you can actually concentrate on the area that you think is more important. You don't have to get somebody to sit down in front of a two-hour video, you know.
Right. Yeah.
So check that out. And by the way, they've been doing a great job of, they have it in so many different languages now, and the Cole videos too.
Right. Yeah, so that's next Saturday, 1 to 3 o'clock at the Belmont Library. So I'll hopefully get a chance to repeat all that at the end, so in case you missed it. So I'd like to just go a little bit over what's happened in the past year, and then maybe after that, mm-hmm. if there's time, talk a little bit more about kind of what we're doing here and, you know, what our motivation is and kind of like our main thrust. Mm-hmm. So it's been kind of an interesting year. We made some actual big strides in the mainstream media. I'm not sure if anybody out there is aware or how many people are aware, but Richard Gage was actually on C-SPAN.
Right. I was going to play that, but you know what happens on C-SPAN? I call up to ask him for permission. And they had the gall to, well, not the gall, I don't know what it is, the arrogance to say, our viewers are used to seeing C-SPAN on a certain channel, and if they happen to see it on a cable access channel, they might become confused. That is a direct quote. I'm serious. He didn't just say, hey, economic considerations, can't do it, sorry. That's all he'd have to say, but he wants to play us off like jerks, you know, and he has no... The C-SPAN people had no respect for their viewers by saying that they would get confused if they found it on a cable access channel as a roll-in. You know. Anyway, so I didn't play that. But you can go. For some reason, Richard Gage has a link to it. Maybe because he was involved with it, they gave him permission.
Well, you can have a link to it, right?
Well,
anyway.
Oh, is that just that's linking? Okay, but it looks like you're playing it. He has an embedded player. But,
oh, okay. Well, it was really kind of a remarkable feat because what happened was the previous year, Andy Steele, an AE 9/11 Truth volunteer, was calling into the show and asking the guest about 9/11.
Oh, the C-SPAN.
The C-SPAN.
Right, that was
it's the Washington Journal
That's
show.
It. Oh man, they had so many people calling that became the issue. You know, why are all these 9/11 people calling in?
Exactly. Yeah, it was kind of an interesting transformation because in the beginning, the host would cut them off right away.
Right.
And the guests would completely not answer the questions and just let you out a bunch of.
They got to the point where the guest had to make the request answer. You know, or you know, sometimes they put them down, and a couple times the guy says, "Well, there's merit to that. I think we should investigate." But so what?
Yeah.
But anyway, it's cool that we're getting the coverage.
Yeah, and so over time, you had actually some of the hosts were saying we're getting phone calls now from people who don't believe the official story is real, and they even showed the website up there a few times. And then the cool thing was at the end of the year, they asked the viewers what they thought was the best story of the previous year. And some of them who we had no idea who they were called up and said, I think the biggest story is those 9/11 truthers that were calling up. And three people did that. And
if you're talking about the media, I think the biggest one was where Geraldo admitted that it, you know, changed his story from giving him the, you know, the finger. Hey, how come the camera is always on him when I'm talking? I got an ego here, you know? Okay, anyway.
All right. So that was a big deal. So those viewers called in and said, I want to see Richard Gage on the show. And sure enough, they put him on.
Right on. And 45 minutes.
Yeah, and they didn't act too disrespectful to the guy. They gave him a chance to say what he needed to say. Just asked the questions. And it was a pretty big success. And then there's the high-rise safety initiative.
Oh, yeah.
Which is another shot at getting New York to investigate.
They tried to
Building
shoot
7.
They put it on camera, too, please. Oh, thank you. Anyway, they had a whole stack of petitions. They only needed, 30,000. And the city rejected a whole pile of them. They took it back in and proved that they were valid, and now we're waiting for them to go line by line. Is that correct? Is that where we are?
Yeah, so there's a couple of issues. At first, they rejected a bunch of the ballots, like you said, even though they had like 67,000 submitted
extras
for like 35,000 required. Mm-hmm. But they rejected them for obviously faulty reasons, so they believe they're going to win that one.
Uh-huh.
But then they rejected the petition text itself on a couple of grounds.
They finally have, huh?
But then this is going to have to be resolved.
Right.
And so hopefully it will be resolved, but they're going to have to get it done by a certain deadline, early October. Otherwise, they'll miss the ballot. So that's probably the strategy, is to stretch it out. Hopefully that they are able to get it on the ballot, though.
Can you tell us about the billboard in front of the New York Times?
Yeah, so they were going to try to do that again, put it across from the New York Times. But
some people don't even know about that. I haven't covered it too much.
Well, so last year they paid for a big ad on a billboard across from the New York Times, and it got a lot of publicity. This year, though, they tried to get the same billboard. Another outfit had already rented it for the whole year. But then they said that you could have it for the month of September.
I understand. They said, we'll give up that 1 month for you guys, but they maintained the option to the very last minute to get the right of refusal, which they exercised.
Right, they did. But then they got a different space.
And this one is killer.
I guess so.
I hope so.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be a video billboard with a motion picture, and it's over a giant intersection that thousands and thousands of people go through every day. They're going to sit there at the light watching this video, which can include, what they said, 15 seconds of actual video of the tower collapsing. So, I mean, they're going to play the Building 7 collapsing, because that's the one that even New Yorkers don't know about.
Right. And when you see it, it's an obvious controlled demolition. Yeah, and you don't get the psychological resistance.
You know,
it was explosion.
I should have invited David Chandler to be with us today. I didn't even think about that. He's local now, so, and he's been on my show before, if we run out of things to say, I've got Niels Herrett and Kevin Ryan to play today.
All right. So hopefully we'll have enough to say.
I'm sure you will. No, I'm just kidding. Go ahead.
Yeah. So the billboard is one thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then a couple of good videos came out in the past year. There was one called September 11, the New Pearl Harbor.
Oh, okay.
By, you know, I forgot.
I did not see that one yet.
Italian guy, I forgot. The guy that did Zero.
Oh, okay.
It's a 5-hour tour de force, this video. It's a must-see. It covers a lot of different topics. the hijackers, the airplanes not being intercepted, all kinds of good stuff like that.
All the different facets of every argument you ever saw, you know, this is our definitive view on that one.
And what was really good about it was that he actually showed the debunkers on there.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the European ones mostly. Uh-huh. But he was able to show what they were saying and then why what they were saying was
not
totally
true.
Nonsense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's funny, they try to rewrite or ignore principles of science. And, you know, David Chandler and I did a video. Well, he did the talking and I did the behind-the-scenes stuff. And it was just covering three main points, irrefutable scientific points that absolutely proved the lie to the official story. Any one point by itself, not even all three, would justify a brand new investigation.
Absolutely, yeah. And then one more video came out by a new guy, David Hooper. It's called Anatomy of a Great Deception. And then the rest of it says something like how 9/11 woke me up, or how Building 7 woke me up.
Even myself, I am suffering from, just kind of overkill. Every time I look on the net, I see something else. Proof of 9/11, something right. or other, or this and that. It gets to the point where I don't even look at them. I'm sure a lot of people don't. But you need somebody to actually look at them and see, well, hey, wait a minute, this one's good. There's a lot of stuff coming out now that they're taking advantage of the Cass Sunstein cognitive infiltration, and people are pretending to be against the official story while putting up such nonsense that, you look at them and say, how did you ever graduate high school? And that's a typical 9/11 truther? No wonder I don't, But they've been doing some wonderful stuff. The videos with the psychologists and the psychiatrist types that the ESO, the expert speak out video has, it's amazing because we never really concentrate on the psychology.
Right.
I don't want to let go of my paradigm. The whole world crumbles if I don't believe America is the protector of the weak, truth, justice.
Yeah, you wonder how those people ever got over not believing in Santa Claus,
Well,
same kind of thing.
No, I mean, it's so many people, you hear story after story about people that right after 9/11, they spent 3 days in the dark space crying because it broke their paradigm,
Yeah.
It's terrible. I didn't go through that because I was educated by a person who knew. My dad was a political science professor. He started out by telling me about World War II. He said that the Germans lost the war, but the Nazis won. And now we're seeing the result of that. Operation Paperclip, we brought all the Nazis to the United States and to the European sector to rebuild all the security of all those states, including ours. And the Nazis founded our OSS. The Nazis are the basis of the CIA. And now neocon is a politically correct word for Nazi because we know what Nazi means. So these folks changed their name to neocon, okay.
Yeah.
That's just my politics. That's not affiliated with Portland AE 9/11 Truth. That was my own viewpoint. Okay. Sorry, I don't want to, but I wanted to think that that you guys are nuts. I might be, but you might not be.
But going back to the video about Anatomy of a Great Deception again, and I'm with mm-hmm. you on that. I think there's a lot of stuff that's repetitive,
mm-hmm.
and you don't even need to really learn anything new. You already have plenty of
anytime I
evidence
see something
already.
With
Kevin,
Kevin Ryan. Anytime I see anything with Kevin Ryan, I go to that right now because he's always right on, so informed, and informed is about the best thing you can say about him because he just digs and digs and digs and puts it together. Thank you.
mm-hmm.
I wish he was local so I could get him on my show, but I don't want to take him away from his work.
Right.
Sorry, I took over.
So this Hooper guy was
we'll do that again.
A person who had no idea about the conspiracy of 9/11 and mm-hmm. just simply had a question about why they didn't get Bush out of the school when they knew there were planes in the air.
That's
and everybody
issue.
Knew where he was.
Bob Bowman brought that up.
And so he started with that, and he made this really excellent video. It's a different style of video where he's just going along question by question. And for a long time, he didn't believe there was anything really wrong with the official story, substantially, but he had questions about it. And it's a kind of an interesting video because you go through the process of discovery and how he takes the next step and deals with it. And it's something that a lot of people can relate to. And it's a different way of presenting 9/11 truth. So I think that's one that's worth checking out. Although you do have to pay for it. It's not a freebie on the net. But
that'd stop me right
one.
Now. No.
And one more topic, though, that was
sure.
kind of interesting to me. And that is there's always been a good case to be made that this committed fraud in their investigations of 9/11 and the Twin Towers. And you can see that just because things that are in the reports are provably not true.
David Chandler pointed that out and actually made him change. Remember when he went in for the draft report on Building 7, he asked him, how can you ignore an easily measurable, quantifiable, and they changed it, but they were too, you know, bleep to say what that meant. When they admitted free fall, but they would not admit that the only way that the building can fall like that is controlled demolition. That's the only thing in the whole world that'll make a building fall like that. Back to you.
So they, if you look, and I won't go into a lot of details here, but if you look at the reports for Building 7, they really had a tough job because they did eventually admit that it did fall in free fall, and it, you could measure that, so they can't really deny it. But after they first tried to cover it up, and then in the technical review of the draft report, they actually came out and said that essentially that free fall is impossible for fire cause collapse.
So they're true about that too.
Yeah,
Shyam Sunder said that one time, and that was at the beginning when he was denying that free fall even happened, because if free fall happened, why, that would mean everything below it would have to be removed. Right. And everybody in the audience, yes, that's right, yeah.
So he said that. Yeah,
but
it's all
then later,
video.
When they were forced to admit it, he didn't go back and review his statement.
Exactly. So they admitted free fall in their final report, but they didn't really explain how their free fall happened.
But David Chandler said another thing about that, and that is that these guys didn't come out and specifically say lies. There may be some, but what he said, they used weasel words and things that later on, when they're challenged, they could say, well, you know, politics and stuff forces, but and it bothered us. David Chandler was wondering, you know, these guys are career scientists. They spent their entire life trying to do things the scientific way, and along comes politics and hammers them and makes them try to write a report that completely negates their entire life's purpose. And, you know, what a shame. There must be plenty of them that would be happy to speak out if they didn't lose their jobs.
Right. So in this particular case, they didn't say that, you know, that they proved that free fall occurred. They simply said, they claimed that their model showed that the exterior of the building buckled by 7 feet. And then they simply said, their only attempt at coming close to justifying free fall is to say, buckled columns have negligible resistance.
Negligible, that's not zero.
It's not zero, and it's not strictly, you can't really disprove that.
Right.
I mean, there are some buckled columns that are very nearly, you know, free fall-ish, depending on how much the buckle is, you know, the angle of it, mm-hmm. and the length of it, and how much weight you have on top. So yeah,
but
that's
that still
not completely
doesn't explain,
a false statement.
I mean, everything could fall. I mean, maybe in certain things like what they're saying, but not that symmetrical thing. That's what really cinches it, because you might argue that on the left side where there was some damage and fire, that happened there, but that doesn't explain all the rest of the building that didn't have heat. And the fires are moving like this, and as soon as they move, it starts cooling.
Right.
So if it hadn't fallen when the fire was there, after the fire leaves, it still won't fall because it's getting cooler, not hotter. And so that's another thing that's wrong. Anyway.
Right. So then they...
It's too bad
really
logic doesn't
cool
apply, right?
Is that, you know, you've got a bunch of engineers who've been after this for a while, and they keep doing Freedom of Information Act requests for stuff. And somebody at NIST made a mistake, and they released some structural drawings that showed some structural elements on the girder.
The flange part that you're talking about?
That
reinforcement.
Adds more proof that what NIST said happened didn't happen.
Right.
So very briefly, I don't want to be too technical,
no, that's
but
fine.
This is really a third grade mathematics problem. You have these beams that are heated up and expanding, and they're getting longer and longer, and they're pushing against this girder. And supposedly, the beams expanded enough to push this girder off its seat, and that caused it to fall down,
but
and everything
see,
else fell down after that.
But not just off its seat, just pushed it far enough to where it was on the flange, and the flange not being reinforced, they said, then bent. That's how it fell. But
that's right. So this Let's don't go there just yet.
That's the key thing. We're getting technical, but it turned out they did have reinforcements.
Right, but even before that, you had the fact that NIST had a model of the fires in the building, and they claimed that those that model got them to 1,000 degrees centigrade of air temperature.
Centigrade even, huh? Okay.
Air temperature. Mm-hmm. And then they said that caused 600 degrees C of steel temperature.
Okay.
And that's what they used for their calculations for the expansion. And if you use the numbers that they give in their reports, you know, the, for thermal expansion coefficient and the length of the beams.
They come up with the same.
You get 5.3 inches.
Right.
So initially, NIST said it had to be 5.5 because the seat was 11 inches wide.
So half of that. Yeah.
About half of that. And they said, and then it was discovered by independent engineers that it's actually 12 inches, not 11.
Oops. Well, then they go back to the other one. I mean, six.
And that, so they basically said that. They said, well, we made a mistake.
Oh, no.
It's not really 5.5, it's 6.25.
Oh.
We just changed some numbers.
Yeah.
But this is like the most, you know, important part of the entire, you know, model. And they somehow made a, you know, fundamental mistake like that, right? But you can't get 6.25, you only get 5.3 still using their own numbers. And now, like you said, and we just discovered that they, it's an I-beam essentially. I don't know how we can draw this to make it work, but what Bill has said is right. If you have this girder, if you have the bottom flange, that's my thumb, the bottom flange, it has to bend up for the vertical part to come down. Well, it turns out there's a big chunk of metal in there that they didn't have in their model.
It makes sense. Engineers know that's a weak point, so they put a little diagonal brace there, a gusset they call it usually. But
so you need to have more than 6.25.
See, the thing is, these engines, that's why when Richard Gates went to the latest AIA meeting, he got, what, over 200 of those engineers to sign on because he started showing them stuff. It pisses an engineer off to, after they put their life's blood into making little things like that. I was responsible for the gussets. Now it can hold so much more weight. We can build and be safe and all that. And then somebody like NIST comes along and says, yeah, the building fell in 6 seconds because of little fires. The engineers obviously didn't think that there'd be a fire. God, I just, it pisses me off and I'm not even those guys. Okay.
So there
you
go.
You, Dave.
And I would say that, you know, David Chandler is right that you want to focus on a small number of things.
Right. We don't have to answer.
Because as soon as you list everything. 20 things out, everybody will like work on your weakest argument, number 20.
Right.
But really, you don't even need to go past free fall, I would say.
And
I'm talking to new people,
we're
just talked about
free
fall.
Right?
And I show them why the NIST report and explanation for free fall is wrong. And that's all you need to know. And if somebody can, you know, dispute this argument, then we'll go on to number two. Otherwise,
right, we're done until you handle that one.
Right,
that's good.
So, so that was good. So this report, I mean, yeah, the drawings were released, and this was found out, and we've got Dr. William Pepper, who is the sort of famous civil rights attorney.
Mm-hmm.
Who represented the Martin Luther King family when they sued the U.S. government.
I have a clip for that today, too, right now already.
So if you're not aware, the U.S. government was found to be liable for the death of Martin Luther King Jr. in a civil trial.
And
the family was awarded $100.
You got a few seconds? We'll play that clip. Yeah, it's already keyed up in there. Hey, you guys, you ready? Hey, Dave, turn around and go back and play that clip. that one we set up.
So while that's happening, we'll just say that.
Here it is. Okay. Oh, we need some audio.
Which perhaps has as much meaning today as it did then. Unfortunately, much of MLK's dream is still a dream. It sits up on a shelf alongside other dreams, like the American dream. No, not that one either. That one. Yeah, that's the one. But only 15 years ago, something else happened, something that changed everything we knew about Martin Luther King's death. And yet, most people still don't know about it. 15 years ago, the only trial ever held concerning the murder of Martin Luther King Jr. was concluded. And no, it wasn't done in someone's basement under the cover of tinfoil hats. There wasn't anyone with the word Illuminati carved in their forehead. And no, the jury wasn't made up of beavers wearing bow ties. right. Because if it were, I would have been there. This was a real live trial between the King family and the conspirators who killed Martin Luther King. All right, this was real. In a civil trial in 1999, a jury found U.S. government agencies, along with others, guilty of assassinating MLK in Memphis in 1968. After hearing from 70 witnesses, including Lloyd Jowers, who assisted the sniper and owned Jim's Grill, from which the shot was fired, the jury took less than an hour to decide that, one, multiple government agencies were responsible for the murder. Two, James Earl Ray, the man we've always been told pulled the trigger, had nothing to do with it. And three, the mainstream media is a stain on the soul of this country. A tarnish so deep and dark it makes the Bermuda Triangle look like a slip and slide. Or perhaps a crocodile mile. You know, if your parents were stingy and wanted to make sure the other kids laughed at you. James Earl Ray signed a confession because he was told it was the only way he'd get a trial. Once he realized he would get no trial, he recanted his confession and maintained his innocence until his death. Even Coretta Scott King and the King family said he was innocent. On the other hand, the 20th Special Forces Group was shown to have a sniper team at the location of King's murder. This is a significant development because snipers are good at putting bullets through things from a large distance away, okay? And it just so happens Martin Luther King had a bullet shot through him from a large distance away. Something tells me the sniper team wasn't at Jim's Grill that evening for delectable cooking. Motto, barbecue ribs are trigger finger licking good. So you're telling me under U.S. law, the U.S. government has been found to have assassinated one of the 10 most courageous, most beloved American leaders, and most people in this country still don't know it? I can't turn on a TV without hearing that some rapper is guilty of weapons charges, or Kim Kardashian is guilty of showing too much side boob, or Donald Trump is guilty of being a bucket brimming full of douche. Everybody in this country knows every step, breath, orgasm, and spasm that involves Justin Bieber, Taylor Swift, or Brad Pitt. Can't avoid it. Can't not know it even if you try. Yet this government, our own government, was found guilty in a court of law of straight up murdering a peaceful disobedience icon, a legend who led the American people out of the dark ages, a modern day prophet, number five on the list of greatest Americans behind only George Washington, Ben Franklin, Lassie, and Balky from Perfect Strangers. All right? And that's impressive because Balky wasn't even American. They were found guilty by a jury in 1999, and we never heard a word of it. Even if you're one of those people who want to go, it was a civil trial, that doesn't matter at all. Does that mean we're not entitled to hear about it and make our own decision? Because there was not a peep from the media. To this day, you're more likely to hear a news anchor, sorry, you're more likely to see a news anchor breastfeed an adult man in a diaper live on the news at 5 than you are to see them mention the only trial ever held on the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. In the words of Mother Teresa, what the is going on around here?
That was great, you know, and I'm glad they beeped out some of that stuff, but he said everything I've ever wanted to say, just a lot better.
No kidding. Yeah, so William Pepper, the attorney who represented the King family, is also representing AE 911 Truth. They're taking this evidence of this fraud and they're trying to actually force the government to correct it. We'll see how that goes. Mm-hmm. But it's at least good to have somebody with that kind of stature behind us. And I was reading the James Douglas book on JFK, and it turns out that it was James Douglas and one other foreign reporter were about the only two people who attended that trial.
Oh boy.
There was no US media there at all. It's ridiculous. Yeah, so that was a pretty full year, I would say. Good stuff happened.
We had all kinds of fun with callers that called in after David Chandler. Not so many while he was here, but people called in and made lots of comments on my website where I posted that David Chandler thing. I even had one guy try to say, I don't pay any attention to David Chandler because he ignored the penthouse. What do you mean ignored the penthouse? We're measuring the fall of the thing you can see, and you know, just stupid things like that. And if you spend your life trying to answer all that, you can't. I got off track, but that is a whole nother subject about what you should answer on the internet or make comments about. You'll see right away that there are a lot of them that say the stupidest things to get you to come back, and you're wasting your whole time talking to a moron who is just playing you.
Yeah.
I guess he's not such a moron then, right?
By design, some mm-hmm. people do that for sure.
What's your video that you have?
Yeah, so let's, before we start that, Bill, I want to just say that, so I think it's important now, we've been going for a long time in this movement to try to educate people, and at some point we need to figure out, once we have our level of awareness reached, what are we going to do with that awareness? Because, I mean, the level of awareness for the JFK assassination, that there was a second shooter at least, is very high, higher than it is for 9/11, yet nothing has happened because of that.
Well, I like the high-rise initiative in New York. I mean, that's going to force the issue, because obviously if the buildings fell like they say they did, we better make sure we have changes so the rest of them don't fall,
right,
or the new ones don't fall. But it turns out that, I mean, it'll force the issue. They can't say, oh, no, forget that, we don't care. They can't not do it. And if they do it, that opens up the whole thing for study.
Absolutely.
And so that's why that's a good thing.
So here in Portland, though, we're looking at trying to figure out what we want to do to not only increase awareness, which is good, required, but what's the next step? And one thing we can try to do is to take the political system and push it as far as we can push it. I mean, that's what a lot of people prefer, and I think that's a good idea. So what we're doing here is focusing a lot of our attention on using the AE 9/11 Truth Petition. And it's good for the organization mm-hmm. to get people to sign up. It's also something that we can use to communicate our political power to our representatives. So we have a pretty strong petition drive going on here in Portland, and the clip that we're going to show is a 6-minute video that was shot in the spring of this year, and it's of me mostly, and so it was a first take, and it has a lot of warts, and I'm not too embarrassed by it, because I really I'm hoping to encourage other people to go out there and do it too. You don't really have to be a movie star to be an effective person for this. So Bill, what's going on?
Technical difficulty there. It'll be popping up any second now.
Okay.
Let's see. You have it? It's coming. Now it'll work. Okay, sorry about that, folks. It turns out that we didn't have our power going. Oh, they restarted the computer, so now you have to find it. Great.
Okay. Well, Well, I can go back. I want to review again what we're doing this week. So in case somebody missed the early part of the show.
That's a good one. And while you're doing that, I'll actually get this going.
So tomorrow at the Laurelhurst Park, we're going to be having a picnic. From 1 to 7, we'll be there. And around 3 o'clock or so, there'll be sort of a work party underway, where we're going to be putting together some signs and highlighting some flyers that we're going to be using on Thursday for some outreach activities at Pioneer Square downtown. So, and at 4 o'clock or so, we'll have the grill fired up and we'll have a real barbecue. We'll have frisbees and footballs and everything out there. So it'll be a lot of fun, and it'll be a chance to meet people in the 9/11 Truth Movement locally and regain your sanity and talking to people who know what's going on and meeting new people. And we'll be talking to other people who are in the park and also in the neighborhood nearby. After that, we'll be doing an event multiple events probably on Thursday. For sure, I'll be out there from 5 to 7. We'll be doing some marching around town with signs and handing out brochures and flyers. And there'll be somebody in the Pioneer Courthouse Square area probably almost all day with signs. You'll be able to find them. If you want to show up at 5 o'clock, I'll be hanging around Starbucks. So that'd be a good place to meet up. And then on Saturday, we're going to be showing the latest, it's a couple years old now, video from Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth, the 9/11 Expert Speak Out video. That'll be at the Belmont Library between 1 and 3 p.m. And Belmont is also in southeast Oregon, Portland, pretty close to where Laurelhurst Park is. Roughly, it's Cesar Chavez Boulevard, just south of Burnside in that area. And the library is just further south of that a little bit. So that's what we have there. And the video that I'm going to show, hopefully we can get to, is... Yeah, go to the main website. So the good thing that I like about getting petitions is that it's very difficult to go out to people that you don't know and strike a conversation with them about 9/11. You know, what do you say? You know, you want to talk about the free fall of Building 7, and they're going to think a lot of people just think you're a nut and brush off right away, and you can't get anywhere. But if you walk up to people, or you know, they come to you, and you're holding up a petition, a clipboard, then they don't know what you are doing. They may think you're doing a marijuana initiative, or who knows. So they're more apt to stop and talk to you, for one thing. And then usually I go through a pretty set of lines. I say, yeah, we have a petition drive for a new 9/11 investigation. I'm with Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. And we studied the three tower collapses in New York, and the official reports don't match the evidence. And so we need a new investigation. Do you want to sign our petition? And usually you'll get like three typical responses. Somebody will say, yeah, absolutely, I want to sign. And it'll be 10 to 20% of the people will say that. And then you have other people who just look at you like you're a nut and walk away. And so those people we really worry about, because they're people who are going to go to their grave believing fairy tales, and there's nothing you can really do to convince them otherwise. And so you're just wasting your time on people like that. But what happens most of the time is that the person just doesn't say anything.
Do you know what video you want? I don't know, I got the YouTube page.
So I would say go down to the main AE site if you can.
Okay. I tried to get there, but it won't let me. I think we're jammed out.
And then scroll down to the bottom, and then go to the next page of news items. It's on May 31st. So a lot of people just stand there like they're stunned, and they don't move, they don't say anything. And so that's like the best opportunity that I've ever seen, you know, consistently to talk to new people about 9/11 Truth. And I usually have the street brochure with me then from AE, and begin talking about Building 7. So the first thing I ask them is if they know about Building 7, and they almost always say no. I mean, like 99.9% of the time they'll say no. And so that's just a great entry point into it, because if you look at the three panel sequence in the brochure, it looks like a controlled demolition, first of all. And then the fact that it was in free fall for 8 stories, that really gives it away. And even if you don't have a PhD in physics, you understand what free fall means, that the top part of the building fell as fast as a bowling ball through the air for 8 stories. Or if you could say that if you had dropped that building into midair, it would have gone no faster than it actually did on 9/11. And so that means that something took out the 82 support columns below the falling part.
C-span one?
No, down, go on down, and you're going to need to scroll to the next page. Okay. You see on the bottom there?
Yeah.
And then it says outreach, you know, go scroll down again. Outreach using the petition.
Oh, okay.
You see it there? 9/11 out, so scroll down. Yeah, you'd have to pick a link. 9/11 outreach using the AE 9/11 petition. Look on the very bottom.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah. Sorry about that, folks. And then I scroll to the bottom. There's a link a little bit up. You see it? Stop. That last paragraph? Yeah, right there. Got it. Okay, so.
Okay, we got it.
It's a 6-minute video. It's of me. So it's if I can do it, anybody can do it.
6 minutes. Sorry about all that, but we got it. We're ready. Are you guys ready in there? Do they have it? Okay, we're ready.
And J.T. Waldron. Oh. Are we still on audio?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, here we are in downtown Portland, Oregon. We're on the park blocks right next to the Portland State University campus. It's a beautiful day today, and we're going to take advantage of some good weather and go out and get some AE 9/11 truth petition signers. Okay, so when we approach people, we're not going to let them know in advance that we're with AE 9/11 truth. I'm just going to hold up my clipboard like this, and I could be any petition gatherer that they're used to seeing in this area of the park. And what I typically say is I get them to stop. I say, do you have a minute? And get them to stop, give me their full attention. And then I will typically say as my first line, we have a petition drive for a new 9/11 investigation. I'm with architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth, and we studied the three tower collapses in New York, and the government reports don't match the evidence. So we need a new investigation. You want to sign our petition. So. Typically, I get three responses after that. I get, absolutely, I want to sign, some people. I get other people saying, no, I'm good, and they walk away shaking their head. And then I get probably half the people will just say nothing. And those are the people that I will then go over the brochure with. So most people, when I say we have a petition drive for a new 9/11 investigation, and I ask them if they want to sign our petition, they just stand there. They don't say anything, and they don't move. So then I quickly say, have you heard about Building 7? And they almost always tell me no. And so what I like to do then is to bring out the street brochure and point to the three-panel sequence of Building 7 going down. And I let them take a look at that. Then I explain that if you look at the videos of that building going down, you swear you're looking at a controlled demolition because it looks just like the videos we see on TV of the Las Vegas casinos being demolished. I point out that no airplane hit Building 7. It fell at 5:20 in the afternoon. It was just across the street from the North Tower. It caught fire when the North Tower came down, and that the government says that fire was the cause of that building coming down for the only time in the history of modern steel frame skyscrapers, supposedly. I then point out that the building was in complete free fall for 8 stories, and that's usually very intuitive to people. They know that that means something besides fire brought that building down. And I point out that literally if you drop that building into midair for 8 stories, it would have gone down no faster than it actually did on 9/11. So that means that some other force was required to take out the 81 support column. Because if it had crushed its way down, then the building would have had to slow down, so it couldn't have been free fall. And that's consistent with controlled demolition. It's not consistent with fire. If they're still interested in hearing more, talk about the molten metal, the evidence of molten metal in at least 4 different forms that I know about. And I like to look at, first of all, the three debris piles. Underneath the debris piles, there were fires that were burning for over 3 months. And for several weeks, at least after 9/11, they were pulling up beams with molten metal dripping off the ends of them. And so that's not consistent with the government's explanation of fire as the cause of the tower collapses, because all sides agreed that the fires weren't hot enough to melt steel, even with the jet fuel. So there's no official government explanation for how that molten metal got there in the first place. And then they don't even talk about it in their reports. So that is consistent with the use of incendiary, though. That along with the iron microspheres, which I sometimes point people to. And the microspheres are thought to be the remnants of molten iron droplets, airborne, that solidified as they cooled. And again, there's no explanation on the government side for how those molten metal droplets got that way. And we do point out that the thermite reaction produces molten iron as one of its two products. So that is consistent with the thermite reaction. And then in fact, I'd like to point to this picture and mention that nanothermite, a high-tech incendiary explosive, was actually found in the dust by a team of scientists and published in a peer-reviewed journal. And so this accounts for the evidence of the molten metal that we see, and the government never tested for the presence of explosives or incendiaries. And once I mention that, most people are just shaking their heads, so they pretty much agree that a new investigation is needed.
Even then, when you got to take down a building, man, you have to actually set the explosives up right to bring it straight down. If it's basically a natural thing, basically because of some type of disaster, it wouldn't go straight down like that. It'd be a lot more chaotic. Because once you open that door, you know, there's really no turning back. Yep. So they pretty much, okay, what can we tell the people basically something they will believe? Well, we already got the tragedy from the plane incident. But how that came down didn't seem about right.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate that.
No problem.
Sure.
I think I was in first grade, and I just walked in, and I saw it on the TV, and I was like, is this a movie, Mom? And she was like, no, this is really happening right now. And I was like, whoa, man. and so, I don't know. It doesn't make sense if you know. It doesn't make sense why they would do that.
So this is what the petition looks like. It's the standard form that Richard Gage uses whenever he does a presentation. It's the paper petition form. We only require 6 fields to be filled out, though, which is the name, email, phone number, city, state, and zip code. Everything else is optional. We don't mind if they fill it out, but we don't require it.
Okay, well, we're back again, and we're going to let David fill you in one more time. We got a caller in, well, we didn't open up the phone lines, but we got a caller asking us to restate the exact coordinates of this upcoming event at Laurelhurst Park. So take it away, Dave.
All right, so Laurelhurst Park is on Cesar Chavez Boulevard, which is also 39th Avenue.
Used to be, yeah, right on.
All right.
I call it 39th.
If you want to know where it is, it's 39th Avenue.
Yeah.
Southeast. It's just south of Burnside. I think the cross street is Oak Street, which is not a very big street, but that's the best place to park. We're in the southeast corner of the park. So Oak Street is a good place to park and get access to our
Actually, there's
site.
Two major areas separated that are Laurelhurst Park, separated by a street. Right.
I think there's like tennis courts maybe.
Yeah, there's one with a playground area, and then there's the duck pond area. So you're in the duck southeast of the duck pond.
We're very close to the duck pond area.
Okay.
Right. So that's happening tomorrow. 1 to 7 will be there, and if you're there like 3, 4, 5, 6 o'clock, I think will be the peak hours. And I want to get back to the petition, you know, idea for a second.
Mm-hmm.
I can't stress how much this has been a great idea for us to use this approach, because not only do we get people on record to be supporters of 9/11 Truth, and we get their contact info so they can get email from us once a month, then from AE once a month if they choose to. Also gives us something to communicate to our reps. You know, it's a show of political power. And also, it's the best way to get out there and talk to people. It's the easiest way to approach somebody.
And I'd like to ask both of my viewers. I'm just joking. Both of my viewers, please. I had one. I don't do anything on Google. I mean, on Google Plus or whatever it is. I don't do any of that social stuff. So I was making a comment to some videos, and a guy came back. He says, "You only have 5 followers on Google. Why should I listen to you?" I've got over 150 subscribers.
There you go.
We're talking about Alex Jones having 3 million, billion, however many, you know, I've got 100.
You don't yell enough, though.
What's that?
You don't yell enough.
I guess I don't yell enough, and the rants I do make have some sense to them sometimes. No, Jones, I got to give Jones credit. You know, when he presents the news that's breaking news, and he's just presenting the facts of what's happening, you can pretty much absolutely rely on those facts, especially when they're live on the center. It's his interpretation that gets a little hyperbolic sometimes, and then I think the biggest problem is that he's trying to fill a time commitment with his contracted radio stations, and once you give out the news, all the rest is just, I hate it, now they're going to take that little clip of me and say I'm a raver.
There you go.
Anyway, people take these YouTube things and edit them up. They can make me sitting down here with Rush Limbaugh. I'd like to meet Rush Limbaugh, but I didn't say that I... Well, let's just stop it right there. So we're going to have one more show right after 9/11 next week, and we'll tell you if there was a false flag event on 9/11, which is a lot of stuff that a lot of people are concerned with. There's, 11 planes missing that somebody speaking for ISIS said, we're going to attack America with all 11 of those planes. And somebody else said that they're invading us through the open borders now with all those immigrants coming in. So it's Obama actually bringing down America, bringing ISIS in. Oh, man. We'll just find out next. If you turn on the TV next Saturday and we're here, that didn't happen. You'll know if it did. I don't buy into all that stuff, but you know, they did 9/11. You got to give them that. What's to stop them from doing it again if they thought it was politically opportunist? Okay, I can't even talk anymore. Back to you, Dave. Gotcha.
Okay. So.
Yeah. Okay. No,
I don't know when you're gonna quit. So.
I know. I got to shut up. We have a minute and a half left, and I'll see you guys later. Go ahead. If you have one last thing to say,
just to close up, I really do hope that people move into an action mode here, where we're getting a pretty high level of awareness now, and we just need to get some more momentum and more motivation going here. And I think we've got a lot going for us right now. But to get more people out there doing things, even if it's, you know, one day, 2 hours a week or 10 hours a month, anything helps. We just need more people out there doing
Even stuff. If it's just copying some of those ESO DVDs and just giving them out, hand them to anybody that will take them. You know, so many people don't know anything about it. And, you know, finally, 13 years later, they're beginning to, oh, maybe I can look at that now, you know. And that's the type of person we're going to try to reach.
Right. So please, if you're interested in doing anything locally, you can email me at portlandae911truth@yahoo.com.
We had that up there before. Yeah. Oh, that was the 11-year anniversary. We have...
So portlandae911truth.org is our website.
And we're off the air in 15 seconds.
So please give an email or look us up, and hopefully we'll see you maybe tomorrow.
See you next Saturday, also on this show.